because Idli has come off that steamer just a few minutes ago and it's extremely fragile, the sort of Idli that breaks under its own weight. That's how soft this Idli is. I've never tasted an Idli as soft and as melt in the mouth as that. This is an Idli that aces in its aroma. Oh, thank you. So there you have it. I have my idli and the vada. And like most traditional places in Namma Bengaluru, it is served only with the chutney. It's soft. There's almost no effort as I break into this idli. This idli just melts in your mouth. Wow. I just placed the idli and the chutney in my mouth and it just melted away. It's as soft as that. In all the many years that I've tasted an idli, I've never tasted an idli as soft and as melt in the mouth as that. I just want to taste the idli just by itself without the chutney. Yeah, that's slightly sour edge from the fermentation. The idli is soft, pillowy. I'm going to taste the vada next with as little of the chutney as possible. I want to get a taste of the vada just by itself. You have that crunch of the vada and inside the vada, the texture is almost cloud-like. It's soft. So as you bite into the vada, you have the crunch of the vada. And as you bite into it, you also bite into those little flecks, those little pieces of coconut, which kind of takes it to a whole new level. And I think there's some herbs in there. I think there's some curry leaf in there. I'm going to taste the vada now with the chutney. This vada is scrumptious. I'm going to take all the chutney and literally drown the vada. Chutney has a minty sort of a flavor to it. So you have the spice of the chutney and you have the scrumptious crunch of the vada. And the vada is porous enough to absorb all that chutney. So as you bite into it, you're tasting the flavor of the chutney, you're tasting the mint, and you're tasting those flecks of coconut that you're also eating. This is a delicious, delicious idli vada breakfast. Go back for the idli. So good. I'm going to get some extra chutney now. The chutney here is so popular that they have a counter and a dedicated person just to serve up extra chutney. And that's what I'm going to take now for the remnant of my idli vada. As you can see, my idli is almost dissolving into that chutney. No, that's how soft this idli is. My last piece of idli, I'm going to take, use all the chutney that I have here to apply on the idli. Salem idli. Well, this is an idli that's been roasted in that butter. I want to taste that idli first. This idli is hot and just breaks away the moment you lift it. Well, this idli sings the flavor of the butter that it was sitting on as it was roasted for those few minutes. And of course, then you also have the butter that's drizzled on top. And then you taste the crunch, the grainy crunch of that chutney podi. So you can taste the lentils. There's a bit of spice that comes from the chili that goes into the chutney podi. And then the wet crunch of the onions. If you're a purist, you may scoff at it and you may say, how can you take a tatte idli and transform it into... Some may call it an aberration of sorts. But then, if you go by the flavors that I'm getting, and I've not even tasted the chutney yet, this certainly is interesting. So because of the fact that they roast the idli on a tawa, the idli also tends to get a slightly dry on the outside, but it's still soft inside. It's soft and airy. And I'm told this idli is purely the rice batter and some urad dal, which is what they use. There is no rice rava that goes into this. And I think this time we're going to taste some of that idli with that chutney. Well, that's a spicy urukadle chutney, as they call it here. The chutney that's made with lentils and tons of chili that I can taste. There's also some kai, some coconut that goes into it. But that's a spicy chutney. Also bit into some chili right there. It's an assertive, aggressive sort of a chutney. But if you ask me, order for the Salem idli, and as soon as it comes to you piping hot, roasted in that butter, topped with that butter and that chutney puri and that onions, go for it right away. Don't let it sit on your plate, don't let it cool down even a bit, because that's really when you taste the full buttery extent of this idli. And the grainy texture of that chutney puri and that crunch of that onion, which is so endearing. But as it cools down and it starts to lose some of that hot buttery fervor, that's when you introduce the Salem idli to your chutney. Because that's when the chutney will come to the aid of the idli and uplift its now subdued, slightly cool flavors. So the sabbaki idli is not an idli that you find in most places. I think this is the first sabbaki idli that we're tasting on the show. So this is an idli that's made with sago or tapioca pearls. You have some rava that goes in and plenty of yogurt to bring it all together. And out here at Gully Kitchen, they also add some sapsige soppu, which is the dill. And this sabbaki idli is served with two chutneys. So you have a green chutney and a kempu chutney. Let's get to that sabbaki idli. I think we'll go with the hands. Well, this is an idli that's not too thick. This is an idli that's small, but the sort that is a bit weighty, because after all, it's made with the sabudana. As you may know, sabudana is a starch that's extracted from tapioca. And I'm told what they use here is the nylon sabbaki. So basically, you have the regular sabbaki and then you have the nylon sabbaki, wherein the starch that's made into these tiny balls is first steamed and then dried. So that's the sabbaki that goes into the idli here at Gully Kitchen. You can see the sabbaki in the dots that you see in this idli. And of course, the flecks of sapsige soppu. Well, enough talking, let's taste the idli. What you definitely smell on your palate the moment you place that idli in your mouth is the aroma of that sapsige soppu that wafts through your mouth. This is not an idli that will dissolve on the palate. This is an idli, in fact, that's also a bit starchy. You can definitely taste a slight gumminess to this idli. As you bite into the idli, you savor the aroma and the flavor of the dill. The dill or the sapsige soppu rules in this idli. You have a bit of tartness that perhaps comes from the fermentation. And I'm told that when it comes to making the sabbaki idli, they also use yogurt that's a bit sour. So perhaps that's also what you taste on the palate in terms of the tartness of the idli. And the ghee drizzled on top rounds it all up in its lush mouthfeel. Let's taste the idli now with the chutney. Let's taste it with that green chutney first. That's a chutney that's definitely spicy. You can taste a bit of the kai, the coconut, but you can taste the spice notes of the green chili in that. And then the seasoning of that mustard seeds or the sasve. I can also taste the toasty notes of curry leaf or karve soppu in this chutney. So the base for this chutney is urukadle or the roasted gram, and you taste that in its grainy presence. The urukadle or the roasted gram is what gives structure to this chutney. But it's the chili, the curry leaf, the mustard seeds in the seasoning that give it the flavor and the punch. You know, when you taste this idli for the first time, and especially if you're used to the sort of idli that quite literally crumbles away or disintegrates the moment you place it in your mouth, this idli is not that. But as you taste that idli, bite after bite, it's a sort of idli that endears itself to you. There's also a tinge of salt that you taste in that idli. And I'm told sabudana or sago is also supposed to be healthy, I think in vitamin D, which I'm told is good for the bones, good for the muscles. And moreover, sago is also something that you can eat when you're fasting. So most fasting foods in many parts of India will always include the sabudana. Let's taste the idli now with that kempu chutney. You can definitely taste the warming spice notes of the chili. And I'm told there's a combination of the Biadgi and the Guntur that goes into it. I suspect there's also probably some tamarind that goes into that chutney, because you certainly detect a tinge of tartness. Oh, that tartness elevates the flavor of the idli. The tartness also comes as a bit of a respite in between tasting the idli and the chutneys. That tartness of the chutney is a sort. It's a sort that endears itself to you. Very hard to describe that. Oh, I'm enjoying that kempu chutney. I think there's also some roasted gram that goes into it again to give it that structure. But I think what really shines in that chutney is the roasted spicy warmth of the red chili and that tartness that perhaps comes from some tamarind. My idli is done, but that chutney in itself is quite tasty. Oh my goodness, this idli is fragile. Oh, this idli is hot. I can barely hold it. This idli has come off that steamer just a few minutes ago. And it's extremely fragile. The sort of idli that breaks under its own weight. That's how soft this idli is. I want to taste the idli first just by itself. That idli by itself has a touch of tartness that comes from the fermentation of the batter. On the palate, the idli is grainy, yet a little tasty. And I can smell the sweet aroma of that idli rice and urad batter. Let's savor this idli first with that runny chutney. That's a spicy chutney. That chutney is certainly a chutney that is bold in its character. Once you dunk the idli into that chutney and place it in your mouth, it's the flavor of the chutney that takes over. There's a certain spice that you taste in the chutney from the green chili. I can also taste the toastiness of that ugarne. So there's some mustard seeds in that. You can taste the fresh crunch of the coconut. There's that aroma of that urukadle, the lentils, and also the grainy bite that you get from that. What I love about that chutney is the balance of flavors. You know, sometimes when you go to a place and you're tasting the chutney, you find a little more of that lentil as opposed to the coconut. But out here, you've got a great harmony amongst all the ingredients that have gone in. You taste the spicy heat of the green chili as soon as you place that chutney in your mouth. But then beyond that, that creamy crunch of that coconut takes over. And then somewhere along the line, you taste the grainy bite of the roasted lentils, of the urukadle. And then you savor the flavors of that ogurne of mustard seeds. I'm not sure if there's some curry leaf that goes into it as well, but that ogurne certainly has a toasty fervor to it. Let's go now for that gatti chutney. So when you come here and you savor the idli, you will typically get the liquid chutney. The gatti chutney is for parcel orders, because there's plenty of people who also come here and take idlis by the dozen to savor in the comfort of their home. But there's nothing like tasting a idli a few minutes after it has left the steamer. If that chutney was bold, well, this chutney is super bold, because there's no water that's diluted the potency of the chili and the other flavors. You know, just a few ingredients that go into the making of this plate of idli chutney, but results in a feeling that's so satisfying on so many counts. I think I'm going to go and get some more of that runny chutney. Thank you. Well, you want to ensure that you soak the idli in as much chutney as possible. That idli is the perfect medium to soak up the spicy flavors of that chutney. Well, there's a lot that's happening here at Iyer Idli. It's a busy street, but while you're tasting the idli, you typically are oblivious to all the commotion around you and you surrender completely to the flavors of that idli chutney. Get a generous serving of that chutney. Coat my idli such that you don't see any trace of that idli and place it in your mouth. That chutney has seeped into every pore of the idli, causing it to disintegrate, to melt away the moment you place it in your mouth. I love the gentle sweet crunch of that coconut in that ghatti chutney. What I love is the way this chutney is balanced. You taste the pointed heat of the green chili the moment you place that idli chutney in your mouth, and then you taste the freshness of the coriander alongside the creamy crunch of the fresh coconut. And then somewhere along the way, you begin to notice the grainy presence of the lentils. And then you taste the ogurne, the fried lentils in the ogurne, the mustard seeds. And although you don't see it, you can also notice the toasty flavors of curry leaves on your palate. And then somewhere through all of that, as if not wanting to be cowed down by the aggressive flavor of that chutney, that idli too makes its presence felt in its porous, slightly pasty texture and a faint tart edge. You know, higher idli is proof that you don't need any gimmicks to sell good food. There's no benne, there's no tuppa on this idli. It's basically the rice along with some urad dal, a bit of salt that comes together to create the perfect idli. And you savour that with the comfort of some chutney. But it's an idli whose making they take very seriously. The rice, the urad dal, is soaked, ground and fermented overnight before they use it in the idli the next day. So although they do only one dish, they certainly take the making of that dish very seriously. And I guess that's the reason why Ayyar Idli, this tiny shop that began 19 years ago selling only idli batter, is as popular as it is today. Well, this dish may come at the very end of my meal here, but this is certainly an idli that I've been looking forward to savouring from the moment I saw it steam over that earthen pot. The Ramaseri idli. That's an idli that's fragile and extremely hot. I think this has just come off the pot. What's interesting texture-wise about this idli is that it has this woven pattern at the bottom, because it cooks, it steams on a muslin cloth that's resting on a net made of twine. I think the weave is also interesting because traditionally the people, the family who make the Ramaseri idli come from a background of weaving. So it's quite interesting that you have a woven pattern at the bottom of the idli, and that idli is thin and it also feels like it's steamed on the top. And I think that's the interesting thing about the way the Ramaseri idli cooks. So you basically have the steam that rises through the idli that hits the top of the earthen vessel. There's some condensation that happens, and that steam finds its way back to cooking the idli from top. So even the top of the idli is a texture that seems to be cooked. Anyway, enough talking. Let's taste the idli. So this is the idli that is soft. I can definitely taste the flavor of the batter that's gone into that idli. That batter, which is a combination of the urad dal and the rice that comes from the Palghat region, which is where this idli comes from, and also some of that menthe or that fenugreek seed that goes into it. So flavor-wise, this idli certainly is quite distinct. What I also feel is that the idli has some weight on the palate. So this is not a typical idli that you will find in Karnataka. This is an idli that has a bit of a weight, and therefore I think that's where these gravies come into play. Whether it's that cheria urli sambar or that country chicken curry or that podi, which is basically made of rice flour, lentils, some spices that come together in some coconut oil. I think I'm going to make a beginning with that sambar. That sambar is thick with the lentils. And that's where the Ramaseri idli comes onto its own, as it carries forward the flavors of the gravy. In this case, the creamy, slightly tart flavors of that sambar. So this is an idli that calls for a hearty accompaniment. Let's taste it with that chicken curry next. So this is a country chicken curry. This is a chicken that's cooked with the skin. So you see some of the oil, some of the fat from the chicken that has risen to the top of the curry, carrying with it some of the spices. I don't know if the inventors of this idli created this to go with some curries and sambars, but having tasted it, I can tell you this is the sort of idli that makes for a great accompanying staple to your curries here. This is not a rice flour batter. Here the rice is soaked and then ground into a batter. So the consistency, the texture of the idli too is soaked. This is not an idli where you will get particles in terms of texture. This is an idli that comes together as a whole, that comes together as a slightly weighty, slightly pasty whole. Let's taste it with that ramasiri chutney pudi. I think you got the crunch of the toasted rice flour. I think there's a bit of chili that goes into it. If you want to break from your curries, I think go for a bit of that ramasiri chutney pudi. With this crunch of that toasted rice flour, some chilies, then also some hingu for the asafoetida. Let's taste some of that chicken. And this chicken is cooked with a bit of skin. And that's what lends that chicken curry all its flavors. So when it comes to country chicken, this won't be as tender as a broiler. But it's a chicken that will reward you with flavor. And this is a chicken where the meat is slightly pink. That's a character of that country chicken. Get all the goodness of that masala. That's a messy bite, but sometimes when the food is tasty, you don't care much about that. All that you're looking at, all that you're focused on is the food. So I've learned from my friend Chef Reggie that the ramasiri idli is an idli that would travel well. Because this was an idli that was cooked over an earthen pot, had no contact with metal of any sort. So therefore, this is an idli that also stayed for a while. So the Mudaliars who migrated to the Palakkad region in Kerala about 400-500 years ago, they would make these idlis to travel. Carry some gravy with you, some sambar or some chicken curry, or even quite frugally the podi. This is sort of idli that would make for a tasty travel meal. Time now to go for the rave idli. Oh, it's so soft that you can see the impression that my fingers have made as I held on to that rave idli. And it's crumbling away, so I better get it on my plate real quick. And of course, you got a tiny katori of ghee here, so you got to make full use of that. This is such a happy looking dish, this rave idli. Speckled with toasted cashews, some coriander, I think some lentils as well. There's a copious amount of coriander that goes into this rave idli. You taste that herbaceous freshness of that coriander in the bite. The ghee was quite assertive when we tasted it with the rice idli. But with the rave idli, because the rave idli is packed with the coriander, with some of that lentils and that yogurt, it tames to a certain extent the flavor of the ghee. So if you want to taste the ghee in your rave idli, ask for two of these tiny katoris of ghee that you can drench your rave idli with. But what I'm going to do next is taste that rave idli with that sagu. This is that potato sagu that is a classic combination with the rave idli. You got pieces of potatoes, you got chunks of potato, and you've also got potato in the gravy. And what I also see are shreds of fresh coconut. Let's taste that rave idli now with that sagu. I want to make sure that I help myself to a generous serving of that aloo sagu, of that potato sagu. That creamy aloo sagu just cradles that rave idli within itself. Oh, I love this sagu. The sagu is very mellow in its flavors. You've got that soft creamy bite of the potatoes, you've got the crunch of the onions, and of course some curry leaf as well. That's a flavorful sagu. That cashew adds a nice toasty bite. I'm going to go for more of the sagu here. I'm going to drench my rave idli with that sagu. You know, it's a bit messy as I'm eating with my hands, but that's the only way to enjoy this. That's the only way to get everything in. I've got the rave idli that I've mashed into a paste, drenched with that potato sagu, make a nice mound of it, and savor. That's delicious. And if you like to spice things up a bit, there's always the chutney that you can introduce to that rave idli and sagu. have one of these rave idli with the sagu and the chutney, and it makes for a nice happy snack. And if you want to make a meal of it, go for two of the rave idlis with that sagu and the chutney. Green masala idli. I want to taste that masala first, just by itself. I love the fresh flavors of the capsicum that you're tasting. There's also a bit of the warmth that I'm tasting from the pepper, and also a hint of tartness. I think the tartness comes perhaps from some of the sauces that have gone into it. So there's some tomato sauce that's gone in, and also some green chili sauce. And I suspect those sauces carry within itself some saring agent, and that's also what you're tasting. That's a masala that is quite endearing. Let's taste that masala now with that button idli. Because that button idli is deep fried, I think the texture of that idli too firms up a bit so as to hold the weight of this masala. So they call this a masala, but the texture of this is quite akin to that of a sauce, because also they add some cornstarch to thicken that sauce, to thicken that masala. I love the pulpy, fleshy bite of that capsicum. There's also a hint of spice that I'm tasting from that red chili powder that's gone in. You're tasting the warmth, the gentle warmth of the white pepper, but you're also beginning now to taste the spicy fervor of that Byargi Mentsinkai red chili powder. I like how that idli has come together to form a dense bite that complements the flavorful weight of this green masala. There's also a bit of tartness that you taste also in the idli. So I suspect the idli is prepared in the morning, allowed to rest, allowed to cool down, because only then, I suppose, can you deep fry that idli. If the idli is hot, it will disintegrate the moment they place it in the fryer. But here they allow for that idli to rest for a bit, to cool down, to firm up before they place it in that deep fryer. I love this. I love my idlis, and I've tasted many versions of the idli, but this to me is quite an interesting idli. You know, it's fascinating to see, this is an establishment that's been around for the last 65, nearly 70 years, nearly 7 decades, but it's fascinating to see that they've taken something as traditional as an idli and given it a new twist. And mind you, this is not a twist that's happened now, this is a twist that's happened 20, 30 years ago. So it's interesting to note that establishments like these that are over half a century old have had innovation in their DNA even 2 or 3 decades ago. And you're also tasting the pulpy bite of some of that neroli, some of the onions every now and then. If you love your idli and you love something a little different, a little masaledar, I think this green masala idli is definitely something to savor. I think that capsicum is quite happy lending this masala its fresh, vibrant flavors that of course is deepened when it meets the red chili powder and some of the other ingredients that have gone into that masala. If I didn't have these two other idlis to be tasted, quite honestly, I would have asked for another plate of this green masala idli. We have a tomato here. I don't think we should waste it. I want to make sure I get every bit of that sauce or that green masala, whatever you'd like to call it, on board this last button idli that I have. That's a look of happiness. The idlis are soft, but you can feel the texture of the idli as you're eating it. That idli quite simply dissolves away in that pool of spicy chutney. I love that soft, pliable texture of that idli. That's delicious. And with that chutney makes for the perfect partner to this idli, to this ekre idli. That chutney is a sort that easily runs over your idli and seeps itself into every pore of that idli. If you'd like to support the work that we do at Food Lovers TV, do consider joining our membership community on YouTube by hitting the join button below or on the home page. You could pledge a nominal sum and receive special privileges like behind the scenes footage, shoot updates, access to live Q&As and a lot more. You could support us on a Patreon page as well. For more info, check out the links in the description below. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe, like, share and leave a comment below. Happy eating!